Ursula, tell us, how did you start making art?
I started making craft. Art came much later for me.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I started working on the techniques of fiber arts before I even knew I was going to do art with it. So I learned how to knit in school, how to sew, and so on. And I'm sort of from the German tradition in that you perfect your technique before you become really an artist.
Well, why do you make art?
I just love to work with my hands. I love to create things. Touch is so important to me.
What does being creative mean to you?
Being creative means you do something with the stuff you have in your hands. So I start with fiber or with fabric or with yarn, and I start thinking, what can I do with this? And I look out into the natural world and see what I see, and I think about, how can I describe that with what I do? I'm trying to show the connection we have as humans with the natural world. That, to me, is sort of the essence of who I am and what my art is.
What kind of creative patterns, routines, or rituals do you have?
I don't have any rituals or patterns. I work whenever I'm in the right frame of mind for it. And I know that if I'm not, if I try and force something because I want to make something for a show or a specific piece and I'm not in the right frame of mind, it doesn't work.
I usually refer to artists as problem solvers. And most people never think about artists this way. What are your thoughts?
Problems. I don't really see problems. I see challenges. And it is fun to overcome challenges. And I do it by just working with the material until it does what? It does something that I'm happy with.
Ursula, what role do you think artists have in society today?
I think artists help us understand our lives, and my specific goal is to connect us to the natural world, which we're part of.
Tell me about your artistic process.
Well, I work with the fiber, like wool. Wool is a magical fiber. Wool comes right off the sheep, and it doesn't require a lot of processing. I can do it directly without machines, which to me is highly important. So I take it off, you know, I get the fleece, I wash it, I dye it, and I card it into fluffy fiber. And then I play with it. I know the names of the sheep that I get the fiber from. And each sheep is individual. Each sheep creates a different fiber, a different quality of fiber. And I just love to play with that.
So Ursula, can you tell us when you start, where do you start with this? The wool comes off the sheep.
And the first thing I do is wash it, and after it's washed, it looks like this. And then you could try and felt that, but if you want more control over it and a more uniform layer of felt, you have to prepare it into a usable form. That's where it gets carded into a fluffy fiber. you take the fiber and you put it on those hand carders. So I put it here on the carders and then I fluff it like that. So there are tons of little combs on there, basically speaking. And it makes a fluffy fiber.
And you do this all by hand?
I do this all by hand.
Amazing.
It's a meditative process for me. It kind of connects me to the indigenous artists here in this area. I don't do baskets like the pomo do, but I like to process the fiber with very simple means. And it, as I said, it is a meditative process for me. So here you go. It turns from something a little bit matted to a cloud of wool fibers.
That's a wonderful description. A cloud. It's as light as a cloud, too.
It is as light as a cloud.
That's lovely. That's lovely.
But then during the felting process, it condenses it.
Fine.
All that air that is in here now gets moved out of it during the felting process. That's how I come up with these solid pieces of felt.
Where's your rock?
Like
okay.
Here. This is the same sheep here. Turned into a very thin piece of felt, but it's very strong.
Tell me, how when you go to make a hat, when you go to make a scarf with felting, or a book with felting, you have that in mind when you start with the fabric?
Yes, absolutely. And the kind of wool that you use depends on the project. So it's very different wool to use for a book cover from a scarf. And you learn that by experience. It took me years to figure out what's the best kind of fiber wool, the best kind of wool. I keep myself open to surprises. And that's also what I tell my students is, felting is not for control freaks. Felting is really works best if you keep yourself open for surprises. Felting is really a process of laying out the fiber in a way, and it takes some experience to know how this will translate into a finished piece. Because you're starting with a fluffy mess here, and you're ending up with a very thin layer of dense fabric. It's such an immediate process. It's a process where you really, you can touch the fiber at all times. The only thing you need to make a felt piece is the fiber, soap, water, and agitation. The fiber needs to be agitated to change its shape from a fluffy fiber into a solid sheet of fabric. So it's a pretty physical process, and that's what I really like about it. So I'm trying to make a book cover here. So I laid out the fiber in the design, and then I need a piece of netting. Yeah, this is a protection. This protects the bat here from the roughness of my fingers. Oops. So I get some soapy water. It's just water with either dish soap or shampoo. And I make this wet. Felting has been around for several thousand years. It's the earliest fiber processing known to mankind. We know pieces in Asia that are thousands of years old, and it is so versatile. You can make clothing out of it. In Central Asia, people were and still are making housing out of it. It's called yurts. You can make slippers, hats, jackets. Now I'm using a little more soap on the surface. And it's all by feel. Feel is so important to me, and it is very important in felting. You have to get a feeling for the right amount of water and the right amount of soap. So your hand glides easily on the fiber. It's a magic process. Because that's what really happens, is you have fibers and they find their neighbors, they interlock, and it's an irreversible process. And during the process, things shift around a little bit, and that's sort of the unexpected aspect of it. The fiber does what it wants to do. And sometimes it's exactly what I want it to do, and sometimes it's not. So I did the top part. Now I'm flipping it over. And I work on the other side. You can work harder, so you increase the pressure. And I keep the shape in mind. I want it to be relatively squarish, although it doesn't have to be. I kind of like the organic shape that felt automatically makes. Because you can embed fabric in your felt as well. Those wool fibers, they are looking for their neighbors that they can latch onto. And in the process, they will embed everything that they can. They will get their little grubby hands on anything they can, including fabric, including this. So that's why I keep lifting this here and there, so that it doesn't become part of my product. I got the surface all meshed together. It kind of feels like suede now at this stage. Yeah. Yep, feel free to touch it.
It does. It's beautiful.
Feels like suede. And then I check and see if my design elements still move around. Maybe I'll work this side a little bit more. So it's really a two-step process. You try and get the surface to become like a suede, to kind of create a film on the surface. And then there are the fibers in the middle, in the center, in the core, that really still need to be coaxed as well. And that's what I use a piece of bubble wrap for once the surfaces are working together. So then I start working it fairly hard on the bubble wrap. The bubble wrap really acts like hundreds of little fingers. The fibers will become very strong, and it takes a little experience to know when you're done, because right now it's soapy and wet. And some of that water that's in it now will afterwards be replaced by air. Yeah, this is about done. You can see I can't pull it much anymore. So here's my rinse water. Here it goes. What I do last is to roll it up in a towel to get the water out. Wool will absorb a lot of water without even feeling wet. I think they say it absorbs 50% of its weight in water without even feeling wet. So then I shape it into the shape I want and let it dry. And there it is. So this turned this fluffy fiber, two layers of fluffy fiber, into this solid, strong piece of fabric.